So we come to our last presentation. So this will be a piece of narrative creative nonfiction by Amy Virando, who is an English and psychology double major, who is also graduating in May. And this will be a narrative exploration on loss informed by Elizabeth Bishop. About John Ashbery, Samuel Beckett, and Elizabeth Bishop, which I feel like is coherent. Getting to lunch with all three of them. Okay. Thank you.
All right. So I actually changed the title of my piece. So it's actually now, This Is How You Lose Her, kind of a shout out to Juno Diaz. So This Is How You Lose Her, an exploration on loss, or a mixed methods exploration on loss, more accurately. So I wrote this piece for my senior thesis. And because it was like an honor senior thesis, I had a little bit over a year to write it. And as you guys all probably know, a lot can change in the year, or in a year. So kind of at first, I set out to try to think of a way to sort of blend my two disciplines, English and psychology. So initially, my proposal looked something like, I'm going to somehow tell a story using like fiction, nonfiction, fantasy, mystery, horror, and name every other genre and insert it into that category. So basically, I didn't know what the fuck I was doing. So shockingly, my nebulous proposal really didn't help me when I was trying to figure out how to kind of tell a story. So I just sort of wrote whatever was on my mind, and at that time it happened to be my mom's battle with cancer. So over time, like I said, it sort of morphed, but my, like, what kind of happened, basically my current piece sort of blends a lot of different styles. So it's structured as per American Psychological Association standards, or APA standards, and it blends text, imagery, prose, poetry, to kind of talk about my experience with coping with loss and losing my mom. So because this was kind of a thing that sort of happened over about a year, it's sort of too long to read all of it, so I'm gonna read some excerpts from this. So I'm gonna specifically read four different excerpts, one from the literature review. Like I said, it's structured in to APA standards, so there are all these different sections. So there's a title page, there's an abstract, an introduction. So I'm gonna read from the literature review, and then I'm gonna read two sort of excerpts from the results section, and then I'm going to read one sort of excerpt from the discussing section, because I think those sort of highlight the different sort of styles and the different voices that are sort of present in this piece. So without further ado, so literature review. Names of poisons, names of handguns, names of places we've been together, names of places we'd be together, names of people we'd be together, names of endurance, names of devotion, street names and place names, and all the names of our dark heaven crackling in their pan. Sicken, 35. So not me, by the way. When my mom was diagnosed with stage 4 intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma on January 19th, 2017, my immediate reaction was to research the disease. According to the American Cancer Society, cholangiocarcinoma, otherwise known as bile duct cancer, is a rare form of cancer, with only 8,000 people receiving this diagnosis per year. Further, the average age for intrahepatic cholangiocarcinoma is 70 years old. My mom was 66 years old. For someone with a diagnosis of stage 4 bile duct cancer, the 5-year survival rate is 2%. Cholangiocarcinoma is not curable. I didn't like these odds, so I decided to dig a little bit deeper into the literature. So Hari Shah Chakutai's, I'm really not good at pronouncing my name, 2013 case study emphasized the importance of surgical resection and successful treatment of disease. Unfortunately, upon discussing this option with a multitude of specialists, my family discovered that my mom's cancer was unresectable. With that knowledge, I began poring over other survival indicators. In their 2012 study, Yusof et al. Explored the clinical features and factors of 69 individuals diagnosed with either intrahepatic, distal, or perihelial tumors, and charted their duration of survival upon diagnosis. The researchers found that survival rates were significantly related with curvative resection. So the p-value is 0.002, negative margin status with a p-value of 0.013, early stage tumor, p-value is 0.016, high tumor differentiation, p equals 0.032, and absence of jaundice, p equals 0.038, at a 0.005 level of significance. Further, multivariate analysis suggested that tumor location was a significant predictor of survival. Upon reading this article, I peppered my dad with questions. Me, Are you sure mom's tumor is unresectable? Him, yes. Me, did mom's tumor have a negative status margin? Him, no. Me, by any chance do you think stage 4 could count as early stage tumor? Him, no. Me, did mom have high tumor differentiation? Him, no. Me, did mom have jaundice? Him, yes. Now for Christ's sake, stop asking me so many questions. So, that was kind of an excerpt from the literature review, and in that I kind of tried to blend my sort of research that I did in direct conversation with my own voice and sort of my own experience. So now I'm going to read a couple excerpts from my results section. So, results. Let's see if I can find the action. Oh, right, this printed double-sided. So, results. Indirect implications. October 21st, 2017. How can you describe the mix of grief, pain, elation, warmth that you felt when sitting down to a meal with your family? You had just driven home to belatedly celebrate mom's 67th birthday. And, according to dad, this is the first time she's been out of the house in weeks. The first time in God knows when Lizzie actually comes out to lunch with you, the rest of your family, and everyone is getting along for once. But this is also the first time that mom can barely walk 100 feet from the car to the chair outside of Egg Harbor. Dad is holding her hand, not because it's cute, but because he's the only thing holding her up. As you all sit down at the cafe, and Lizzie and you banter about what hot chocolate to order, barista-made or machine-made, you watch mom slowly fade. She is quiet and apologizes she can't be more conversational, more interesting, more upbeat. Her face is ashen, and you, Lizzie, and Dad all rush to fill in the silence, joking that if she were more with it, the four of you would likely be arguing. But in that moment, when everyone is getting along, you long for the time when any table was a battleground. You long for the heated arguments, because that's what people do when they think they have time to make up. You're too afraid to be pissed off at someone who might not be around tomorrow. Results. Direct implications. 1. I learned to write an obituary. See Appendix C. 2. I dream of her. 3. My dad rearranges the house. 4. I begin to believe in ghosts. 5. I get new clothes. 6. My dad does the grocery shopping. A. Lizzie eats raw tortellini for lunch every day. 7. I write thank you notes. 8. I see my dad cry. 9. We buy a new vase for our fireplace. A. It is filled with ashes. 10. I drink tea. 11. My fourth grade teacher writes our family a note. 12. My friends look at me as if I'm damaged goods. A. So does my hairstylist. B. So do my grandparents. C. So do our neighbors. D. So does my reflection. 13. I look at my dad and Lizzie in the same way. 14. Lizzie buys a gym membership. 15. I stop going home every weekend. 16. Lizzie calls me. 17. My dad waters her plants. A. I water her plants. 18. My dog claims mom's spot in the bed is his own. 19. I visit her office to sit amongst the remnants of her life. 20. My dad reads her journal. A. Lizzie reads her journal. B. I can't read her journal. 21. I lose myself staring into pictures of her. 22. I lose myself at the sight of her handwriting. 23. I lose myself when standing in line at Starbucks when I hear, "Tulsa had chocolate, no whip." 24. I lose myself driving in Kentucky. Every street name, a name of a racehorse, a reminder of Churchill Downs. 25. I miss her. 26. I lose myself when I hear Jean, or jeans, or jeans, or mom, or mom, or mother, or mommy. 27. I lose myself. 28. I lose myself in missing her. As you can see, I really tried to play with that rigid structure of the APA guidelines, but I also sort of tried to insert my own voice and kind of try to play with that narrative. Results, they can be direct implications, or they can be indirect implications, and you can kind of take that how you want. So I kind of tried to do that in this piece. So finally, I'll read for you an excerpt from my discussion section. And in this section, I really kind of try to play with that voice of, a researcher and then kind of just as a normal human being who doesn't talk in a robotic APA standard voice. So, discussion. The purpose of this study was to explore loss, to better understand how we continue to live in the wake of these devastations by examining my, the researcher's, experience losing a parent. For me, this experience highlighted how full loss is of contradictions. Further, it forced me to live with ambiguity, as I could never fully commit to anything, afraid something would happen and I would have to return home in a moment's notice, while all the while forcing me to live with the acute awareness that my mom was fading faster than a rainbow in the desert. I realized I was surrounded by people, caring people, the cards and casseroles and calla lilies strewn throughout my house, but I also realized that people can only come so close to my pain. And therefore, in spite of their proximity, I felt utterly, desperately, achingly alone. I began to cherish, relish every moment I spent with everybody, but every moment became bittersweet, laced with the crisp, sweet knowledge that in this moment, I had these people sitting right here with me, but also laced with the kind of melancholy that creeps up on you, the acrid awareness that these people in this moment are fleeting. This loss put other problems in my life into perspective, yet I couldn't seem to see anyone else's problem, especially other struggles, through anything but my own loss-tinted lenses. Whenever I think of her, I smile and fight back tears. I ask myself, how can I continue living on without her? But then I also ask myself, how can I not? All these contradictions. Thank you.